So we'll get started. Thank you for joining this afternoon and welcome to Pizzazz Your Presentations. The purpose of today's webinar then is to give you an insight into some of the key features within PowerPoint, some ideas that you might want to put into practice when you're creating or editing presentations. Before you start putting any presentation together, it's always a good idea to consider a couple of topics before you begin your content. So first of all, what's the purpose of your presentation? Is it going to be to inform somebody, to explain something, to persuade, maybe persuade a customer to buy from you? Who is the audience going to be? Are you presenting to colleagues? Is it customers, creditors? And what type of presentation is it? Is it going to be lots of fun? Is it going to contain lots of facts? And then once you know all this information, you can start to pitch the content right. And you can also plan to start to make the content appropriate. For example, you don't want lots of cartoon images if you're delivering your business plan to the bank. But similarly, you don't want loads of facts and figures if you're delivering a presentation to children. We offer other courses in this to expand on the content of today. So we have courses on Microsoft PowerPoint to go into what I'm doing this afternoon in more detail. And also the softer skills courses, which are designed to help you plan and structure your presentation and actually how to stand up and deliver your presentation to an audience. But the purpose of today, as I mentioned, is just to give you a taster of some of the features in PowerPoint that will hopefully help you to build your presentation with a variety of content. So I'm going to start off with an existing presentation, not much in it. So this is my project overview presentation. And there's only two slides in here. So to begin with today, I'm going to start by looking at how we can get some content into our presentation if we know it exists elsewhere. So I know that I've got some slides in another presentation that I've done in the past that would be really useful to put in this presentation too. So it'll just save me that work retyping. I could just open the other presentation, select the slides, copy and paste over, or I can import the slides directly into this presentation. So I've clicked on the last slide in this presentation because I want these new slides going at the end of the presentation. And on your ribbon, I'm sure you're all familiar with how to put a new slide into your presentation. So we have all these various different layouts. But I want to reuse a slide, an existing slide that's in another presentation. So right down at the bottom, I'm going to reuse slides, which brings me up the Reuse Slides panel. There's links in here, so I can open a slide library in SharePoint. I can open up a PowerPoint file. And I've got exactly the same options in the Browse drop-down list. So I'm going to browse for a file, which is on my desktop, and it's called Project Planning. And there we go. We can see all the slides that's in that Project Planning presentation. And you can see that these slides have got a theme behind them, so like a little bit of a watermark going on. The slides that I need from this particular presentation are the slides called Timeline. So just a single click and the slide is inserted into my presentation. And it takes on the theme for this presentation where it's landed rather than continuing that theme over, which is good because I don't particularly like that one. I'm also going to bring in a slide called Dependencies. So we have dependencies and resources in here as well. It's going to save me a whole load of time rather than retyping that information. Now I've clicked individually on the slides that I wanted from here. I just want to show you that there is also, if I do a right-hand click on one of the slides, insert slide is the same as click, but I could have inserted all of them on a right click and applied the theme throughout the presentation. I've got all the slides that I need now from this particular presentation, so I'm just going to close the pane at the right-hand side of the screen. I don't need it anymore. Now, I also have some content in a Word document that I need. Again, I could copy and paste. I just want to show you some hints and tips, really, with regards to how Microsoft Word and Microsoft PowerPoint can talk to each other. So I have this Microsoft Word document. And what I would like to do is the headings, the sort of like the main overview, the content, I would like them to go into a PowerPoint presentation. I don't need the detail behind that. I just need the headline information. The detail I'll talk about when I'm actually delivering my presentation. So in order to bring this information into a Microsoft PowerPoint from a Word document, the Word document needs to be formatted using styles. Excuse me, styles is this section in Microsoft Word on your ribbon at the top of your screen. And basically, a style applies uniform formatting throughout your document. So for example, this is a heading level 2 style. I can see that. And if I wanted all my heading level 2s to be, let's say, italic, rather than changing them all individually, I change the style once. Go on then, let's go red as well. And all the level 2 headings are changed in one go throughout the presentation. Now, some of the content is formatted using heading level 1, some, as we've seen, heading level 2, some, heading level 3, and then we also have the text that's formatted as normal, so the content is formatted as normal. So when I pull this information into PowerPoint from Word, PowerPoint will take the heading level 1 format, so the heading level 1 styles, and put that as the title of the slide. Heading level 2s will go in the text box and there'll be a bullet point. Heading level 3s will be sub-bullet points in the text box. Heading level 4s, if you had them, sub-sub-bullets. All the way up to heading level 9 if you'd formatted your document that way. Anything that's formatted as normal won't come through, which is fine. It's just the, like I say, the headline data that I need to pull through. So I'm going to save my changes to this Word document. It's all formatted as I like it to be. And close out of it. Again, I've clicked at the end of the presentation. I want the new slides to go at the end. I'm going to go back to new slide on the ribbon. And instead of reuse slides this time, I'm going to go for slides from outline. An outline of heading styles is it talking about. So I need to just find the file which is on my desktop. And hey presto. Anything that was a heading level 1 in my Word document comes into the slide title. Anything that was a heading level 2 is a main bullet, and heading level 3s are sub-bullets. The only thing I don't like really is Times New Roman and the colours. I would really like the text in these new slides to reflect the other slides in my presentation. So I'm just going to simply click on the slide and reset it. Click on the slide and reset it. Perfect. So now they fall into line with the rest of my presentation. I did mention earlier that you can use copy and paste. You've probably all used copy and paste before. Do you want to just use the chat panel and let me know, yes or no? Have you used copy and paste before? So there's Inga, yes. Yes, Justin. So a lot of you just saying, yes, you know how to use cut, copy and paste. What I'd like to just go into here is have a look at cut, copy and paste special. I'm going to create a new slide at the end of my presentation. And I just want a title on that slide. And I'm going to put project costings. Okay. I don't need to add the content. I want to put a chart in here to show me the project costings. But I already have that chart in an Excel spreadsheet. It's like Blue Peter, here's one I created earlier. So I already have the chart here. I'm going to select the chart in Excel and just copy it, just standard copy, nothing special. Go into PowerPoint and I'm just going to paste the chart in. Now, copy and paste from one program into another, so like from Word to Excel, the program that you're pasting into does its best to say, this is what I see that object as. So because it is possible to insert a chart in a PowerPoint presentation, and charts is almost like a little app that both PowerPoint and Excel uses, so the chart has come in as the chart object. I've got the chart tools, design, format. And if the data's wrong in here, I can always go to edit the data and change the data in Excel. I don't really want to do that though. What I'd like to do is, if I have this data I'm going to copy the chart again. Already in an Excel spreadsheet, I use this spreadsheet day in and day out and change these figures all the time. However, the PowerPoint presentation, I look at it once in a blue moon, and I don't want to have to keep opening the presentation and changing the figures every time I change them in Excel. So instead of just using paste and getting a chart with all the standard tools, I'm going to click on the drop down arrow and use paste special. So again, do you want a yes, no? Let me know if you've used paste special before. I could paste this object in as a just as a Microsoft Excel chart object. Also, there's a few no's in there about paste special. So I could paste it in as an Excel chart object, so I get the functionality of Excel within PowerPoint. So let's have a look at how that would look. So it comes in, looks like a picture. I don't get the chart tools, it's coming as an object. However, I can double click on it and have the functionality of Excel, but within PowerPoint. So if I change some of these figures, you can see the chart changing straight away. And then when I click away from the object, the chart's adjusted. But that unfortunately won't have had any impact on the Excel spreadsheet. So I'm not sure now which is right or wrong. I'm going to assume the Excel one's right. So I'm going to delete this chart, because what I actually wanted was, if I update the figures in Excel, PowerPoint updates as well. I'm going to copy this chart for one last time, and using paste special, I'm going to paste the chart with a link back into the original Microsoft Excel source data. And if the figures, so if I move out of this way for a second, have a look at the big purple section there, which is the total in 8,000. If I go back to the Excel spreadsheet, which is now linked into PowerPoint, I'm going to change that figure to 500. Watch this purple bit change as soon as I press enter. So the purple bit's changed in Excel. And hey presto, it's changed in PowerPoint. And even if I didn't have the Excel spreadsheet open, you can at any time double click on the object, which will take you back into the Excel spreadsheet, the underlying file, change the figures, and the presentation will have updated to reflect it. That's exactly what I was looking for that chart. So now we have a little bit more content in, so we've got a few more slides in our presentation. Just going to move that one around. It does look, just from this side panel down the left here, it does look a bit dull, very text, very boring, very black and white. So you can introduce objects into a presentation just to add a little bit of interest. But you do need to make sure that the objects that you're putting in are appropriate. As I was saying about not having too many facts and figures if you're presenting to children. And I'm just looking at my slide number two here. It doesn't have much content in it. To be honest, that's all I do need. Those are the only bullet points I do need. But it's got all this empty bit over at the right-hand side. So I'm going to put an image in there just to fill the space and add a little bit of interest and break it up a little bit. So if I click on the title of this slide, so there's just two objects. There's one big text box and one title. Rather than starting again, because I want to put a picture over here, I'm simply going to change the layout to say this slide should be able to hold two content. So it's created me still title, text box at the left, and at the right, I can use one of the icons to add a smart art, image, video, table, or even more text. Well, I'd like to put a picture in, so I'm just going to click picture. And he's handsome, we'll put him in, that will do. Perfect, and it just adds a little bit of interest to your presentation. Just a little yes or no, did anybody have fuzzy felts as a kid? Did you have that little fuzzy felts thing as a kid? Just send me a yes or no. Yes, yes, love fuzzy felts. PowerPoint is pretty much fuzzy felts, but electronic version. So basically, the slide in the background is almost like your fuzzy base, and then what you put onto the slide are like the felt objects to create the overall effect. Each object has special tools that goes with it. So for example, if I click on the title, I can see up at the top of the screen, I get additional drawing tools so I can format that title. Maybe with word art, I know that Lee Carton really likes word art. If I click away from the object, those tools disappear. If I click on the picture, I get special tools. So this time it's picture tools where I can go ahead and apply some formats to the picture. So there's some predefined styles here, and just by hovering over the style, you get to see a live preview of how that style is going to look. And then when you've got one you like, simply click on it. In addition to picking the predefined styles, you can then choose a border. You can choose a picture effect, so a shadow, a reflection. You could put a glow around it. You can also choose different layouts for your picture. The picture itself, you can put some artistic effects on the picture to maybe make it look like a glass window, or it's been drawn by in pencil. And again, just click. Please don't be worried about practicing with these tools that you have on the ribbon, all these formatting options. Because if you make a mess of a picture, just click on it and reset it back to how it was. And then you can start again and try some other selection of tools. I think with this one, less is more, I think that will look good. Okay. Let's move on and have a look at my timeline slide. So I've got have some text in here, and this could be quite factual text. I still want to see the text in there, but it looks really, really boring. So there must be something I can do to keep that text, so keep that fact, that data, but just add a little bit of interest to it. So on this slide, I'm going to highlight all the text, and instead of having it just as bullet points, I'm going to convert the text into a smart art graphic. You need to be careful how you say smart art. PowerPoint gives you some predefined graphics to go with. Alternatively, you can go into more graphic options. So from process, I'm going to have a scroll down and maybe go for an up arrow. Perfect. So I've still got the text, still got the information that I need in that particular slide, but the smart art graphic is just adding a little bit of interest in the background. Again, we've got those tools that are specific to smart art. So we've got smart art design, so like pre-formats, or I can apply my own formats. So from the designs, let's have a look at what we've got here, some various different styles. Quite like that one. We can change the colours. And even if we don't like the graphic, you can change the graphic totally. Perfect. So with smart art graphics, just to show you that one more time, on dependencies and resources, so we've got a main bullet project, and underneath we've got sub-bullets. So to display that as a graphic to show that project is the main one, I'm going to go to more graphics and cycle, and let's have a look at this one. So the main bullet project goes in the middle with the sub-bullets coming out the side. And just adding a little bit of interest by changing the style and the colours and even the layout. Seconds, and it just vastly improves the content of your presentation. So now we've got some content in the presentation. We have added a little bit of interest to the presentation. I need to start thinking about the overall appearance of the presentation. And PowerPoint gives you a number of predefined themes to put in your presentation. And your themes include things like graphics, colours, fonts, special effects, background styles. And what's lovely about PowerPoint is the tabs on the ribbon are almost in the order that you would build a presentation. So you've got your basics on the home tab. Then you put things into your presentation. Now we're going to have a look at the different designs that you can have in a presentation. So predefined themes from Microsoft. Again, if you start hovering over them, you get a live preview of how that particular theme is going to look. And simply click then to update the entire presentation. Once you've got a theme that you like the look of, you can go and have a look at the different variants for that theme, so different colours. You can also apply different fonts. So I quite like Arial, it's the easiest one to read. And any special effects that you want to have. So we'll go glossy, I think. And there we go, a couple of seconds, and our PowerPoint presentation as a whole has been updated. Now with PowerPoint, if you've gone to the trouble of customizing one of these themes that we have here, so it looks how you want it to look, the next time you come to do a presentation, rather than trying to remember it was this theme, this color, this font, this effect, you can simply click on the drop-down arrow next to the themes and select Save the current theme, and you can use it later. So we will call this project theme. And if I create a new presentation, I can simply apply that design. Save you a whole load of time. Particularly, can you give me a yes or no? Do you have corporate look and themes that feel to your presentations? Yes, yes, most definitely. So you just use them over and over again. Now, all the work that I've done so far in this particular presentation has been in the foreground of the presentation, so the actual information that changes from slides to slide. What I would like is to put our corporate logo in the bottom right-hand corner of every slide in this presentation, maybe with a difference on slide number one, title slide. Now, if I was to put the logo in, I could copy and paste it to all the slides. But then what if somebody comes along and moves it on one slide or deletes it off another slide, and then I have to go put it back on again, and it just doesn't have that professional feel when you're running your presentation. So what PowerPoint does is it gives you what are called masters. And masters are a little bit like transparencies that sit behind your slide. Before we look at masters, it's important to just remember, I'm just going to go back to the home tab and new slide. There are lots and lots of different layouts, different slide layouts that you can use to build a presentation. And each one of these slides will have its own master. And again, I don't particularly want to change all of these in the presentation. There's more masters, if you like, more layouts than there are slides at the moment. So PowerPoint has what's called a master that controls all the smaller masters that sit below it. And that way you can just make one change to affect the whole thing. So slightly just changing the view of the presentation. I'm in normal at the moment. I'm going to change this to slide master view. And if you have a look down the panel down the left, these should look familiar to you. That was like the drop down arrow with new, and these are all the different layouts that I can have. So this is the master that would change a title and content layout. If I scroll to the top of the panel, there's a master, the big one at the top. And this will control all the little masters underneath it. So on this master, I'm going to insert a picture. I'll put our logo in. And let's say I want it down at the bottom, in the middle. Not quite in the middle, but never mind. On the slide master tab, I've finished with the master now, so I can close master view. And you can see that on all the slides in the presentation, the logo is there. It's in kind of the wrong place. I think it might be better sat in the bottom left corner. Easy done. Go to View Master. Go to the big master. move your logo into an appropriate position, make it a little bit smaller, close the master view, and all the slides in the presentation are updated accordingly. As I mentioned, the only one that really doesn't change with that is the title slide. And the reason that is, when you insert a title slide, it's generally to introduce a next topic so people know, oh, this looks different to everything else that I've seen. So title slides do often look different. Again, slide master, and in the title slide layout, so I'm just going to change this master, insert picture, and I'll put it in the top left corner on this one. Close master view, and my slide masters are changed as well. So those are masters. Now that I've put those logos in, I can't click on them, select them, move them. They're there. Unless I go to the master view, I can't change them. So my presentation's coming together now. We only had two slides and it looked a little bit dull, but it's looking a little bit better now. So we've had a look at the insert tab. We've put things into the presentation. We've changed the design. We're now going to move on and have a look at transitions. Now, a transition effect is the way that one slide disappears off the screen and the next one moves on when you move from slide to slide in a presentation. You can have different transition effects on all your different slides, but that just looks like you've been having a real good play around with PowerPoint and it doesn't look very professional, if I'm honest. You're better having that consistency all the way through. Some of the transition effects are a little bit garish, like let's have a look at honeycomb. No, I think it's a little bit too much. But then other ones, for example, box, are quite nice on a PowerPoint presentation. With the transition effect that you've selected, you can then at the right of it choose the effect options. So this is changing from box from right. I could do that from the bottom or from the left. But I think it makes more sense to come from the right. Looking at the slide miniatures in the navigation pane down the side, only one of the slides has a little star on it. None of the others do, which is telling me that only slide number 4 has a transition effect. If I click on the star, it will play the effect for me. I would like that same transition effect applying to all the slides in the presentation. So let's do apply to all. All the slides now have the star. I'm going to run the slideshow from slide number 1. Using the chat, does anybody know which F key you press to run a presentation from slide 1? Fastest finger first. Anybody used the keyboard shortcut? Use the chat panel and let me know. No? Okay, have a look at your keyboard. There's a key there. F key's at the top, F5. We'll always run your slideshow from slide 1. And I'm going to press escape now to stop the presentation. So transition effects are great if you're wanting to just add that little bit of impact into your presentation, but not too many. Keep it subtle, keep it professional. So where we have transition effects affecting how each slide moves onto the presentation, animation effects to animate the objects actually on the slide. So if you're thinking about the fuzzy felts, transition is the fuzzy background and the animation is the felt object. And I'd like to animate this text box that I have here in issues and resolutions. Because at the moment, if I run the slide, it just all appears on at once. And it's taking away all that mystique. I would like to talk about these headings a little bit and big them up a little bit before I see the next one. So I'm going to add an animation effect. Now with animation effects, they're red, amber, green. So the green ones are the entrance effect. So this is how the object would come onto the slide. Emphasis is the object is already on the slide, but you want to draw attention to it. And the exit is how the object goes off the slide. And you can even add motion paths as well, so you could have it go in different corners of the slide if you wanted to. You can have none of those effects, which I've got at the moment, any one, any two, all the lot if you want to. But you just need to bear in mind, each time you add an animation, that's more clicking as you're running through your slideshow. So let's have a look at some effects that we've got here. I would like these objects to float in. Ooh, didn't quite like that. I don't know if you noticed what and how it impacted, did it impact the project? And time, cost, another all came on with that main bullet. So if I run the slideshow from this slide, so going back to F5 would run it from slide one, shift and F5 runs it from this particular slide. So as I was saying, with the animation effect, I now have to click and I can talk about all the description. And then when I click, I can talk about how it was resolved. Only when I'm ready can I click and talk about how did it impact the project. But I didn't want these three coming on at the same time. So I'm going to press escape and have a look at the animation effect. So this says it's coming on click. And this one is coming on click. And this one's coming on click, but I can see that they're all numbered as item number 3. So by looking at the animation pane, expanding these down. Oops, let me get that out of the way. And have a look at the options. So the timing is coming on click. And the text animation, it says it's going to group the text by the first level paragraph. If I group it by the second level paragraph and click OK, so now I can see I've got individual numbers. I'm going to just use Shift and F5 again to run the presentation from this slide. Click, first one comes on, click second, click third, and notice how those other three bullets don't come on until I'm actually ready and click to add them. I'm just going to escape that. Just a point to note with animation. If you choose an animation effect, so that was an entrance one, and then choose a different animation effect, you basically just wipe the first one off. If you want more than one, so let's go to, let's have this bouncing in. So I've now got an entrance effect. If I want more, I would need to add an effect, not change the existing one. So we'll have a teeter. And remember, you have those effect objects. You can have it as one big object, one by one, and level. So that would be level one. These would be level two. So let's do it level one by one. Oh, it's going to take a little bit of time. So why it's always good to practice your presentation so that it's appropriate for how you want to deliver. Obviously, we'd cover that in a lot more detail in our actual courses, but hopefully that's given you an idea of some of the things that you can play with. And remember, if you don't like it, you can always just go back to none and wipe it all off. I think our presentation's kind of getting there now. So we've got content in here, we've got graphics, we've got a theme, we've got masters, we've got transitions, we've got animation, we've got the whole kit and caboodle going on. So before you actually run your presentation, you really ought to time it to make sure the timings are right. Now, sometimes you're given presentation timings anyway. So if you're going for an interview, for example, you might have 8 minutes to get your message across. Or for a training session, really important to get your timings right. Even if you don't have any time constraints, you ought to know how long your presentation is going to take you so that you can let your audience know at the beginning so they know what they're in for. It's nothing worse than starting a presentation or sitting at a presentation thinking, am I going to be here for 5 hours? If the presenter says this will probably take about 5 or 6 minutes, then you know what you're in for. So in order to rehearse our presentation, I'm going to go to the next tab along the ribbon, all nice and logical. And from the slideshow tab, I'm going to rehearse my timings. So what this will do is it will run through the presentation with an extra little toolbar for you to see how long each slide is taking. when you're rehearsing your timings, don't sit in your chair reading through it going, no, 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 no. You won't get a true picture of how long it's actually going to take. Stand up. If possible, get yourself in the room where you're going to be delivering your presentation and pick points on the wall as if they're people and you're talking to different people and changing your focus. Then you'll get a clearer picture of how long your presentation is going to run. So this slide's been on for 28 seconds, so I'm just going to click to move on. Excuse me. Normally you would go through this properly. I'm just going to quickly click through each slide in the presentation. All of those quickly. Oh, they're emphasizing now, look. And at the end, it says the total time for your slideshow, whereas about 4 seconds. Do you want to save the new slide timings? Yeah, I'd like to have a look at those later, so I'm just going to save those slide timings. So now that we've saved them, I can't remember how long is this slide going to take me. I can't actually remember. But if you have a look at the views in the bottom corner of PowerPoint, there's a slide sorter view which shows you a miniature of each of the slides. And underneath this, each miniature, you can then see how long each slide is going to take in your presentation. So this one's taking zero seconds. That's not great. I'm going to select that slide. And from transitions, it says it's going to last for, that's better. So we've changed the transition effect. Now, please bear in mind that if you've, on transitions, if you've said play this slide after X amount of seconds, if you cough or sneeze or somebody asks you a question, you might then have to be playing catch up and talking at 100 mile an hour. So just be careful if you're going to use your timings. So I'm going to turn those timings off and apply to all slides. So they've removed. So now I have to advance from one slide to another using a click. Okay. Now it's a good idea for you to check the slideshow settings before you actually start running a slideshow. Quite often these days when you're running a presentation, you've got a nice screen on the wall and you've got a separate laptop. So you've effectively got two screens. So in slideshow, let's go into set up a show. You can have this option to show your slide on different monitors. So what you could do is show the slideshow to the audience on your primary monitor. And then on your second monitor, you've got your presenter view. Now, presenter view has three areas to it. It shows you a miniature of the slide that you're on at the minute, the comments for the slide, and it also shows you the next slide that you're going to be running if you've got presenter view active. I haven't, but just for the purpose of this particular webinar. So I'm just going to go back to normal view. In order to put your slide notes on your comments, either click the notes button at the bottom to show and hide, or just resize the notes box. These notes would then appear if you're using presenter view. So just make sure you've got all those tools set up. And let's just have a quick look at running a slideshow. So F5 again to run from slide number one. If I just wiggle my mouse, I don't know if you can see that faint down at the bottom, we have buttons to navigate from one slide to the next. You can also use pen options. So you could have a highlighter pen to highlight some text as you're running the slideshow. You can have a look at the additional tools. So you can end the show whenever you're finished. You can also right-hand click and maybe pause the presentation. I want to quickly jump to slide number 6. This is difficult to demonstrate when you're on a webinar, but on my keyboard, I'm just going to type 6, enter, and it takes me straight to slide number 6. To get back to number 1, 1, enter. If somebody is asking you lots and lots of questions as you're running through your presentation, you can pause the slideshow or black it out. And the key for that is B for blackout. Now, if you've blacked out your presentation and you're in a room with a blind shirt, you might have just plunged everybody into darkness. So I'm just going to press B again to bring that back. And if we white out the screen instead with a W, it might just shine some light back onto the presentation. Now, with blackout and whiteout, it does pause the presentation for you and displays just nothing on the screen at all. But you can actually right-hand click and pause your presentation at any time. Now then, do I want to keep my annotations, so that yellow highlighting? Not really. I'll discard that. One last thing I'm going to show you before we finish today. I've been many places where before a presentation started, that the presenter has gone up to the front with a memory stick, and they've had we can see all this on the screen. There's a screenshot of the files that they have on. They find the one that they want, they double click on it, it opens up in PowerPoint. Everybody can see the gubbins of PowerPoint, they can see the slides and know what's coming. And then at some point, they use the button down at the bottom to run the slideshow, and it's horrendous. If you save a presentation as a show, let me just demonstrate this one. This is the one that I started with. Pizzazz Your Presentations. Slightly different icon to PowerPoint. Double click, you don't get to see PowerPoint. You just get to start the presentation to run the slideshow. And it's really good as this if you wanted to email the presentation through to somebody as well. They don't have to run it in PowerPoint, just run the slideshow. In order to get one of those, you would do File, Save As, and let's put it in Pizzazz Your Presentations, Joe's presentation, but I'm going to save it as a PowerPoint show, not as a presentation. So if I was to tidy everything up, close out of everything, and put that Joe's presentation on my desktop and actually tidy my desktop up, when I come to run the presentation, simply double click and the presentation runs without you looking at the whole gubbins in the background. But please do remember, so this presentation is Joe's presentation. If you change the presentation itself, you will need to resave the show that goes with it. Resave a slideshow. And I think from what we've set out to do today, we've had a look at quite a lot there. We started off with a very little in our presentation. We had a look at adding content in and using copy and paste. We've put some other content in, so we've got some pictures in there, and we looked at the masters. We've changed the design and actually saved our theme for later use. We have some transition effects and animations and some hints and tips for running a slideshow as well. So I hope you've found it quite useful this afternoon and have some ideas of how you can put presentations together going forward. Before we finish, has anybody got any questions? Do you want to use the chat panel at the right? Just let me know if you have any questions. No, it doesn't look like it. Well, there is a short survey when the webinar's finished, so if you want to use that and any questions that you want to ask in there, you know how to get in touch with me if you do have any questions going forward. Please do feel free to join any of our other free webinars that we've got running next week. Hope you have fun with PowerPoint. Thank you for attending. Have a lovely, lovely bank holiday weekend, and take care. Stay safe. Thank you. Bye.